Right. Yeah.
So, recording.
Okay, everybody. We'll get started with our first session of the day. Thanks very much for joining us, those of you that are on Zoom, those of you that are here in the room. We're very pleased to see so many of you here. We've got a really exciting day of presentations and discussions ahead. Our first panel is looking at the use of short films in the classroom and other non-formal education settings. The way that the panels will work, we have three speakers who will speak for around about 15 minutes each. And then at the end, they'll all sit down here and we'll have a discussion. So very much encourage questions from the audience, whether you're in the room or via Zoom, and we'll have a good discussion about the issues raised in the presentations afterwards. So our first panel is on using short films in the classroom, and we have three speakers. Our first speaker is Anthony Chalmers, who is from GMac in Glasgow, and he's the head of youth and film education. Something like that, yeah, he's nodding, so something like that. Then we have two teachers. We have Isabel Sarran from Inverurie Academy, and we have Louise Sedgewick from St Margaret's Academy in West Lothian. So we'll hear from Anthony first, then Louise, then Isabel, and then we'll have a conversation afterwards. If you're on Zoom, you should see the slides being presented full screen as well, and obviously you'll see them in the room. Okay, so without any further ado, Anthony, do you want to come up and join us? I'll just share the screen. There we go. So your slides should be, full there. Thanks very much, Anthony.
Thank you. Hi everyone. So I'm Anthony Chalmers. I'm an independent filmmaker. I make short films and independent writer director, making films for no money, just trying to make stuff and get to a place where I can make my own films more and more. But I also work at GMac Film, and
you might have to switch to the
like this. Yeah, okay. Just to get the logo up, it's not that exciting. I work at GMac Film. I'm the Youth and Education Manager, so teaching young people, or people of all ages actually, filmmaking techniques, getting them practically making stuff, and learning about storytelling and all the aspects of filmmaking as a way for people that want to get into the industry, but also as a way for people to just be creative. Film's an amazing tool for developing soft skills in young people, collaboration and creativity and sharing ideas and stuff. So we do a lot of that, a lot of programs at GMac Film. Some of the big ones, we run the BFI Film Academy, which I'm sure most of you will be aware of. We do it in Glasgow. It also runs in Edinburgh and Aberdeen and somewhere else in Scotland, maybe, I'm not quite sure. I mean, there's about 40 of them in England or something, and there's like four up here. But the Film Academy is like a great course. We've also got a new exciting project with Cashback, so we're going into schools doing taster sessions, getting young people into filmmaking training. Little Pictures is our commissioning scheme for short films, so people who are filmmakers that want to make their first sort of commissioned work go through that for micro-budget short films. And we've also got employability schemes, so Screen Start just ran its first year, and it was a bunch of people focusing on craft roles, so not writer-director types. More people that are getting into locations, accounts, fighting, stage fighting, all of that stuff. So we've got lots of access routes into the organisation. And through all that work, we also talk a lot about short films. That's what we're here to talk about today. And why do we talk about short films? Because they're short. If you're making films and you need to get started in making films, that's what you're going to make. You're not going to make features. It's nice for the classroom or for teaching circumstances, obviously. The thing is short, so you can watch it over and over, you can get the whole picture of the story, you don't have to, can't tell you how many times I've showed scenes from Jaws over and over, wishing I could just show Jaws, but I never have time. So short films, you can at least get to go through the whole story. But the problem with short films is this quote, which I know we've all seen before: sorry for the long letter, I didn't have time to write a short one. It's the same with short films. It's hard. Making short films is hard. Short stories can be hard. They can be harder than feature films. The way that we teach story and things like that can tend to be quite sprawling and things like that. And how do we get to young people or to people in the classroom? How do we boil down their ideas into something that's manageable that they can make with what they've got? And another problem is most people that you're working with don't watch short films. And I've kind of jokingly put, does anyone? Because as a filmmaker, we joke about short films being for filmmakers. You know, you don't tend to see kind of Joe Blogs on the street talking about their favourite short film. And it's not right. Short films are their own art form, and they've got you know, some great storytelling, but most of the time they're treated as a stepping stone. And I think the more and more that these are used in the classroom, the more that they're explored as part of media or just film education in general, then of course the more hopefully prominent they'll become. But yeah, as filmmakers, when we're all sitting, you know, around having a pint, sort of complaining about not being able to make stuff, we're like, oh no, not short films, come on, we all want to make Jaws, basically. So a big reason though to sort of show short films for me as a person that's been practical and getting people making films is inspiration. You know, like obviously you watch feature films and you're inspired by it, you get into film because you're inspired by it in some way. So watching short films is hopefully to just see the breadth of types of short film that you can make and that is out there and inspire them to come up with their own ideas. So obviously we talk about the practicalities of filmmaking and we get them talking about their kit and how to frame and things. And we talk about all aspects of the process, so what it's like being on set in the industry. Even in like classroom settings, I'll do this to try and get routine because that helps. And you know, we want them to kind of express themselves and make the film that they want to make. So we teach all of this stuff, and obviously we also teach story. I'm not gonna just teach you guys story stuff, but this is my stuff. I love story. I love stories with an ending. I love you know, teaching story stuff. So we've all seen kind of thesis, antithesis, synthesis. There are three acts of a storytelling. We've got a flawed character. We confront them with their opposite, and we synthesize the two to achieve balance. You know, we all talk about stories as being the same, but can be different. But these fundamental aspects can be useful. And obviously in teaching, that's what we're doing. We're not saying this is this necessarily when it comes to creativity. We're saying this could work, but you know, you can also do anything, right? Like we hate to be too prescriptive. George Saunders, who's an author and a teacher, talks about, you know, as soon as you get certainty in teaching and in creativity, you kind of lose something of the work, basically, because you're certain. So, but we have to teach something. So we teach these things as a kind of fundamental building block that they can explore. And then obviously that gets us to our acts, and John York's book Into the Woods is kind of my Bible for this stuff. So we all kind of know our three act things, but ultimately again, we know it can be anything. Stories can be anything, films can be anything, but we just use this as a building block. And because of that, obviously short films can be anything too. There can be any type of short film, any type of story, and you know, it's just trying to find a way to get the young people a sort of entry point. Because another quote from Alexander McKendrick on his book on filmmaking, student films come in three sizes, long, too long, and much too long. And that applies obviously at the short film level too. So we're trying to find a way to give them a brief or, as I say, an entry point into trying to make something that's manageable, whether it's in the classroom or whether it's in one of our big projects where we've got, you know, a big crew and sort of industry level stuff. And obviously that can be challenging, so that's why we teach those building blocks. And that's why we are, you know, looking for ways to sort of give a brief, be specific, so that young people can grasp onto something. So what I was wanting to just talk about briefly, and very briefly, because I was doing a sort of writing for a short film course last summer at GMac, and it was just a bunch of people, kind of early 20s, I guess, so a bit older than maybe most of you are working with, but I've also done this with teenagers as well. We just watch a bunch of short films, inspiration and all of that, a bit of fun, and also for theory stuff as well, as I'm sure you all do, and analysis. So we, as a collective, I mean, I had some ready to go, but ultimately as a collective, we watched some shorts and we observed things that could potentially apply to shorts that maybe don't traditionally to features or to longer stories. But this is the beginnings of, this is something I'm constantly interested in talking about, but ultimately, you know, for any academics in the room, it's a very small data set I've got today. It's just a couple of short films that I tend to like to show people. But it's just the kind of general observations as somebody who's been in this world making independent films a lot and watching a lot of independent shorts, these type of things can happen. First thing to say is, though, you can do it all. And I'm talking about short films kind of 15 minutes or less. because as soon as you get to your kind of half hours, your red balloons and things like that, some of the Lynn Ramsey ones, obviously that becomes still a problem for time. They're amazing films. But so I'm kind of focusing on 15 less most of the time, because most of the films that we're making as a group are 5 minutes or less, trying to get them to be as short as possible, but it makes them harder. So you can do it all. So a film that I like to show is called Wonder Day. It's Tim Key, some of you recognize as a comic, and it's like 15 minutes short, and it is quite traditional, act one, act two, act three. You know, you feel the story, but there's some good discussion, and it's also a bit of fun. So you can do your traditional sort of storytelling. But if we're talking generally, so an obvious one first is just a limited number of characters and locations. And, you know, obviously this is tangible for young people because they can go, oh, I'm not going to write, you know, an ensemble piece with six people. I'm going to hopefully boil it down to a character or two so that we can focus on that. And the same with locations. I mean, obviously this is good for logistics in terms of money, but you can't run about everywhere doing everything. So we're trying to be specific. Quite often short films can have a single visual idea and then play with that constantly throughout. So a lot of the short films we watch, we can tend to observe this. So a couple of examples. There's this film, Stand By a director called Charlotte Regan. And this film is basically this set up from start to finish. You know, the two people in the car, and it just kind of jump cuts between time. And we see the story of these two characters in the one set up as they do their shift. And obviously that kind of image is subverted when one of them's not there, the other one's not there, and blah, blah, blah. So you can kind of do things like that. Lights Out is another short film I'm sure most of you have seen or used, by David Sandberg. Plays with this visual idea of when the light goes off, we see a shadowy figure, but when the light's on, we don't see them. So it's, again, it plays with that and then subverts it at the end. And then The Black Hole, which is another one I've seen a lot used, visual idea of a black circle on a piece of paper being used to reach through things. So quite often you can play with this visual idea. It can be something like that, like a concept, or it can be in terms of the actual frame, and you just sort of repeat it and subvert it and play with it throughout. And then a general short film thing as well is a kind of subversion from the expected. Sometimes people talk about short films like jokes that have a punchline. Sometimes that can be a bit kind of confusing, because then people focus too much on the punchline and everything that comes before it doesn't necessarily matter. But subversion from the expected could be good. So this is a little micro short that I quite like to show. It's called Tune for Two. And it's very sort of standard, you know, playing with what we know about media. Somebody's getting kidnapped, they're getting thrown in the boot, they get flung outside, and they've got a gun to the head. And then they start singing Mana Mana from the Muppets. So the guy that's like got the gun to his head going, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do, and he's like crying. And then the guy there is like starts dancing and goes, Mana Mana, do-do, and it just goes on like that. So it's like a thing that we know, playing with our understanding of media and then kind of subverting it. And I see that quite a lot. I think there's also an example of a similar thing, actually. It feels like somebody's getting kidnapped and stuff, but it's telling the story of a Christmas tree. So it's like getting dragged around, and then it goes into the chopper at the end or whatever, and it's like the story. So yeah, sometimes a subversion, a kind of joke-like format, a sketch-like format can be quite prominent. Also often, because of the length of them, we tend to have a moment in time. So that could be like a sequence, you know, an evening, but sometimes you just get short films that are a scene. You know, they're a scene length, and a thing happens to a character, and it's a bit of a time and place for them. This is a great short film called The Climb. It got adapted to feature, but it's these two guys cycling up a hill, and it's basically a drama between them, one of them revealing that they'd been with the other one's girlfriend, basically a partner. So there's a whole argument, you know, you could argue it could be a play or whatever. But it's great, really cinematic as they climb up this hill, so it's a moment in time. So it's like this moment for coming together between the two of them. This film, Lapse, is the one. It's definitely for older students, just if we're being literal here, because it deals with some heavy themes. But it's like 4 minutes long. Charlotte Wells, you recognise the name from After Sun, fantastic short film. You can see here the kind of the command of the craft that Charlotte Wells has. This is done all in close-ups, and it's kind of creating a moment of tension in a character's journey when they're assaulted on a train, specifically. But all of that is really kind of creates a tension, and again, it's about this moment in time. Short films tend to have little to no traditional first act. We don't have half an hour to set our world, to set our characters, set our story. Like all filmmaking, we want to instantly be able to tell the story from the visuals, so tends to be a kind of thing. We're getting empathy with the character in the first shot, and we're kind of understanding their world in an instant. Cargo, another one adapted to feature, is about a guy who's a family who the mum's been bitten by zombies, and he's got the kid and he has to get to a place, but he realises he's been bitten too, so he hangs a strap of meat from the front so that he walks, and the baby's strapped to his back, so he just continually walks until somebody finds the baby. But anyway, it kind of sets all of this up just by a car, and you see these little people on the side of the car here, and he like rips off the mum thing, do you know what I mean? The little sticker of mum, and it's kind of supposed to be a kind of quick fire way of doing that. And then they're also less likely to wrap up conclusively. We talk about drama being change. A character changes, you know, they've learned something. There's an argument to a film and they've learned something. Ultimately, because of the timeline of short films, it's unlikely that change is going to be quite as dramatic, quite as big. And if it is, then usually it falls because it's not sold in the time. You know, if you're telling a film story in 10 seconds and you fundamentally change somebody, you're kind of going to lose something, whereas features maybe get more chance to really change a person. And, you know, Jesse Armstrong, the creator of Succession, would argue that, you know, change in characters is very, very hard. You know, people don't change, or when they do, it takes a long, long time, and a lot of things has to happen. So you tend to see that a lot. A great short film by Eva Riley called Diagnosis, which is kind of plays with the moment of time thing. It's not got a first act. We have to learn about the character throughout the drama. And, you know, it leaves us kind of ambiguous, I guess, maybe would be a term. And also short films are good because of their length, because of there are maybe less, less stress on them. There's more capacity, more room to experiment. You know, really we should be encouraging people, students or filmmakers, to experiment and try things. And this is also where I just lump films that I don't know how to categorise. So there's this, I've not changed the title, apologies. This is called Necktie. It's a short film by Yorgos Lanthimos. It's like 2 minutes long or something, and I can't tell you what it's about because I don't know. But it's great, so I would encourage you to watch that as well. And, it's just about exploring. You can do anything. But ultimately, short films should still strive to be about something, because I think the thing for me as a filmmaker watching short films, because of some of these things that we allow for shorts, people just make things that just exist. You know, they don't have a central dramatic argument. They're not saying something. And I always say to students, it could be saying that you love a certain type of crisp. You know, it doesn't have to be a big political statement. A film should be trying to say something. Otherwise, it just kind of, you watch it and you go, why? And Craig Mazin from Script Notes podcast talks about, you know, you get the note, what's the film about? You know, we know what it's about, but what is it about? You know, and that's the kind of thing that we always try to encourage. So watching short films in terms of making short films is just a really great way to inspire and get people going, and hopefully encourage them to just try things. But these little stipulations, these little observations, I have personally found helpful in teaching and getting people to make their own stuff, just because it's something a little bit more tangible. Teaching the three acts and then them going, oh, so I need to do this. It's like the thing of, you need to come into the room, they need to sit down, and then they need to get up, and they need to leave the room and all that. If we try and cut that down, we get something a bit more tangible. I was going to show film, but that's my time, so I'll not. So,
I'll show film.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's only 3 minutes when I cut off the credits. So apologies to those young people. But so I'm just going to show a film that we made as part of our BFI Film Academy last year at GMac Film. And you know, this works. It's like 16 weeks. The students all learn different craft roles, and then they pivot and focus on their own short film. And it's a big short film, so it's like 16 people on the crew and then a little behind the scenes crew. And we try and keep it as people-led as possible. We've got industry mentors for each department, but ultimately this was a script written by young people, directed by young people, and we went to film at Film City in Glasgow, which was a good location. So yeah, I'll show this. And it kind of, through the writer, the young writer, you know, we talked about some of this stuff in the writing process to hopefully get to a stage where she could come up with an idea.
Honestly, this place gives me the creeps. I just want to be in my bed, jammies on, binging Christmas films. What do you mean it's not Christmas yet?
So? It's November now. Time for the first Christmas film of the year. Right, ugh, look, I don't have time to argue, right? I best get back to work and get out of this creepy place. I don't get paid enough for this crap.
Are you alright, love? Oh, I'm so sorry, I didn't mean to startle you. I've just been doing a wee bit of maintenance in the building. Jesus! I was just getting started, and then the power went out. I didn't even care you were in here.
Thanks very much, Anthony. That was excellent, really interesting, and lots we can pick up on after our next two speakers. So next up we have Louise Sedgewick from St Margaret's Academy. I'll just load up your PowerPoint. Let me share the screen again. Okay, there we go.
Okay, thanks. Hi, I'm Louise Sedgewick. I am an English and media teacher at St Margaret's Academy in Livingston, where I have been EEC for 17 years now. Is it going to work? Always have to use a Star Wars reference, it's a favourite in my household. It feels like it was a very long time ago that I started using film in the classroom. As a student teacher at Murray House, at this very university, I started using film in the classroom because I was introduced to using moving image by Margaret Hubbard, who came and did a session with us, and it just captured my imagination, and I've been using it ever since. So this is a wee picture from one of my classes doing a filmmaking task this week, actually. This comes from the Bradford Film Literacy Project, just in case anyone needs convincing of the use of film in the classroom as a tool for teaching and learning. The Bradford Film Literacy Project carried on for a number of years. There's a link there on the PowerPoint to their website. And this here is just a condensed version of their reasons behind why film education is so valuable as a teaching and learning tool. It provides children and young people with a huge amount of valuable educational value, really. So it encourages learning, critical thinking, critical understanding of different texts. I know Robert has got feelings about describing films as texts, but I think it's a universal word, so I will use the word text. I apologise to Robert for that. It encourages debate. It's great for listening skills. And also, I mean, you can use it in any classroom across the school because of the wide applications of using film. So why short films specifically? That's what Robert had asked me to speak about and compare it to the use of feature films and how I use it in the classroom. So first of all, it's time. You can easily fit short films into classroom lessons in a way that you just can't manage with feature films. The longest lesson I have in a school week is with my higher media class. I have a double period with them, which goes across our lunch, which is an hour and 50 minutes long, and that's the longest I have. And yes, there are some feature films that fit into that time, but it doesn't leave you a lot of room for anything else. And most lessons are not that length of time. Most of the time we're dealing with 50 minutes, maybe. So it's really time effective. You can fit them into lessons. It's one of the really positive aspects of using short film. In terms of resources, it tends to be easier to resource short films that you can use in the classroom than with feature films. Things like access to different streaming platforms has caused various issues over the years. It's not always the easiest thing to get hold of in school. Whereas short films are available in a wide variety of places, largely freely available. In terms of the cost as well, it goes along with being able to access these things. A lot of it is freely available, which is a particularly important aspect right now when budgets are absolutely, at a minimum in schools. There are lots of student-made examples which we can use when we are teaching short film in the classroom, and you can say, look, here's an example of things that other pupils have made, and they can see that and think, well, that's something I can do. Whereas, students are not making feature films, so that's not something if you're doing feature film, you can draw lots out of it, obviously, but it's a really great example of things that they can see. If you can see it, you can be it. It's the same format they're going to be using when they make their own films. In terms of things like narrative structure, which Anthony was talking about earlier, the different film language that they're going to be using, so camera, lighting, sound, etc. And as an art form in itself, just as Anthony also said, short films, just like short stories, are not actually that easy to do. To be concise, to be brief, to get it all into a self-contained narrative actually isn't that easy. So in itself, it is a valuable thing to do. It's a valuable thing to study for its own purposes. And yes, it is time effective and it is cheaper and all these other wonderful benefits. But in itself, I'm really passionate about teaching short film in the classroom for the sake of short film. So how is it different to feature films? You can use more than one short film in the same lesson to exemplify a particular feature of film language, for example, without having to draw together lots of different clips from different places, which is another teaching tool, but sometimes in terms of time that you've got available to you, that's also an issue. You can watch a short film repeatedly, sometimes in the same lesson, and that's not something you can really do with a feature film in terms of time, because when I'm teaching a film, if I'm thinking about, for example, higher media or higher English, where I also teach film, we're not going to be able to watch the entire thing, the whole thing, all the way through very many times in the term. So you can do that with a short film, which you can't do with longer texts. Character setting and themes don't have lots of time to play out. So it tends to be a really good example of character design, a really obvious setting, for example, where people can recognise it on first viewing. So it's really good for exemplifying concepts that you want them to use themselves in their filmmaking, or you want them to understand for approaching feature film for film analysis purposes. They won't be making feature films in school, therefore it makes more sense to use an example of something that they're going to be trying to do for themselves. Barriers, well, there are always many barriers to accessing particularly digital media content in schools. We had real trouble over lockdown and online learning with accessing materials, which is when short films really came into their own, because there is such a huge amount of them available on different online platforms that everyone is really familiar with and are pretty freely accessible. But one of the big issues that teachers have is time. We have very little time for preparation and planning, and it's difficult to source appropriate material if you're starting from scratch, you don't know where to begin, etc. So that can be a real barrier, because you want to do a good job of it. You don't just want to stick stuff on in the classroom and hope that you can, you know, bumble through it. You want to do a good job of it. As I said, teaching short film in the classroom is valuable in itself, because there are so many excellent examples out there. But teachers' time is a big issue. Also training. A lot of people do not feel confident in their ability and knowledge. We do not currently have a qualification for teaching film in Scotland. This is something that is and it's in planning stages. It's certainly something that people like Robert are really keen to get up and running. I was fortunate to do a course at Queen Margaret University in film in the classroom, but yet it's not yet established. A lot of people feel like if they didn't have film in their degree, that they don't know enough about it. So teacher training is something that's certainly a need that's out there, and it's what stops a lot of people from using film in the classroom. But it's another reason why I think short films are such a great choice, because not just for the children, but for staff, using short film to teach teachers how to use film in the classroom is really accessible and something that you can do a really good job of. I'm an Into Film Education ambassador, and when they first started their film clubs and rolling out training for teachers, I went to every single course that they did in 2014, which is how I ended up being an ambassador for them. And every session that they did used short film to do the training for teachers, and it was a really great way into it. So this is how I approach using short film in my classroom. You might have heard of the 3 C's and 3 S's. This is something that Into Film use frequently. I'm just reminding myself of how long I've been talking for. So I've only put 4 of them up there, but this is, you know, to try and keep it straightforward, to try and keep it a brief. So camera, we think about size of shot, you know, the movement, the angle, framing. Character, get them to think about the role that the characters are going to take on. What are they going to be in the film? What actions are they going to carry out? Are they going to look a certain way? Are they going to have a particular costume? Get them to think about story, so narrative structure. I always get them to storyboard first. And then, are they going to have an opening? How do they want it to start? What's their point of conflict going to be? How's it going to resolve itself? How's the film going to end? And then sound. Are they going to include sound? Sound is always a tricky one. There's a lot of difficulties with recording sound. For anyone that's ever made a film will know this. A lot of the films that they make end up having no dialogue or no recorded sound that they've done themselves, but using sound effects or music or additional dialogue or a voiceover, for example, to get around the recording of sound issues. Some of my recommendations for where to find the short films that would use in the classroom to do the teaching with. Screening Shorts, the Screen Scotland bank of films is really excellent. It's got a huge number of short films, actually. I've written some of the resources for it, and it's a wide variety of things that are suitable from early years education right up to, you know, 3 to 18 whole curriculum. Covers all sorts of topics. There's animation, there's live action, there's documentary, and there's fiction. And some of the ones I'm going to talk about in a minute are from that site. The Into Film website has a lot of resources associated with a huge range of films. Into Film Plus is their free streaming service, which is available to Scotland schools. You just need to sign up for a free Into Film account. And there's a QR code you have to scan to show that you're in school, but it does work. Disney Plus is a really good place to find things that I use in the classroom a lot. For example, Spark Shorts, which I'll speak about a wee bit in a minute. Pixar Shorts are also really great. There's loads of really good ones for using in teaching. Vimeo, which I noticed you had mentioned, Anthony, is a good place to find short films. Just use the search function, think about the theme, the idea, put in, just type in short films, you'll come across a lot of different examples. YouTube, there's a huge amount of short film available on YouTube, both professionally made short films and also those made by students, by people in the community. And just Google it. My advice is that if you're not sure, you will be able to find it. Use key terms. You will find a film that suits your needs if you just Google it. One of the tools that I use in filmmaking to get them started with making films is stop motion animation. Largely speaking, I use cut paper, but sometimes we do things like plasticine or Play-Doh models. Sometimes they want to use things like Lego or other toys or other objects to tell a story. I once had a group who did a story just using their shoes, and their shoes followed a path through the school, which I thought was quite creative. This is a picture here of someone two girls making a stop motion using cut paper against a backdrop, and they were trying to solve issues of shadows, and lighting, and not having proper clamps or stands to make it steady. So they were doing it up against the backdrop there. But it's a really engaging filmmaking activity. In the last few weeks of term, we've started a new timetable, and I've had two classes making short stop motion animations. Now this one here, I'm hoping it'll play. Will it play for press? Play, press. Oh no. There we go. So this was made by one of my higher media students, just using the stuff that was on his desk. Super short, but he never made a film before of any description before he started doing higher media, and had his jotter, had some paper, cut out a stick man, not the greatest artist in the world, and still made something that I think was, a really creative thing to do. Most of the rest of the class were making things like sharks and, having explosions and people doing cartwheels. And so I thought that was a wee bit different, so I thought I'd share that with you. Filmmaking does not have to be like super long, and if you don't have to be scared of it. It's not as difficult to get into doing it as you think it is. You yourself do not need to be an expert to get the young people that you're working with into making films as well. I definitely don't consider myself an expert in filmmaking. I've had pupils making films in my classrooms, as I said, for 17 years, and I've done it for a long time, but just letting them go on with it often brings up really great results. This one was from this week. And you'll see that there are some issues there. Well, we didn't have a tripod, and she's also got boxes of pencils that she had her phone rested on in the shot. But again, this is someone who has come into a media class never having made any moving image before, never made a film, apart from mucking about with her friends, etc. But I thought that was a nice wee animation to show you too, to show that cut paper can give you some really good stuff. So these are short films that I use in the classroom all the time. The Lucky Dip by Emily Skinner is available on Screening Shorts, and it's an animated film. It's a lovely wee film based at the seaside, featuring a little girl who gets taken there by her grandparents, and there's an element of danger in it and drama and a pretty scary rabbit. There's Dangle by Phil Trail, which I absolutely love. I think it was done in Germany, but there's no dialogue in it. There's no language barriers there at all. And you just have to watch that film. I'm not going to explain it because I think it would spoil it. But it always goes down really well in the classroom. Virus by Simon Hines is also available in Screening Shorts, and it's a short horror film. It's a live action horror film. Horror is a very popular genre with young people. It's a very good one for teaching film and media because it's got such obvious genre markers in it. And I'm currently marking higher media exams for the SQA, and there are a lot of people who have studied horror movies for that reason. Mouth of Hell by Samir Mahanovich is a very different type of film. We're thinking about decolonising the curriculum. It's certainly one that you should go and have a watch. It's based on real life of children living in India in a very dangerous situation. And it's a really hard-hitting film to watch. It's for older, you know, secondary school pupils. You wouldn't do this at primary school. But it works really well in getting them to consider other people's experiences that they would not have come across. This is not something that you're seeing on the news, but this is what some young people are living with. Father and Daughter by Mikhail Dudek-Dewitt is an animation, and it's a really beautiful wee film. I use that in our S2 media course. All the pupils in our school do S2 media, and they all study this film, and it goes down really well. It works very well for teaching a lot of different aspects of film, including a really beautiful relationship between a father and a daughter, and how you can tell a story really simply without any dialogue and without even having particularly complex animation. It's very simple animation style, but it's a lovely film. Float by Bobby Rubio is one of the Pixar Spark Shorts. They asked their staff at Pixar to pitch, who weren't filmmakers already, who worked in different departments doing different jobs, to pitch ideas for films a few years ago, and this is one of the films that got made. And it's a really beautiful wee film about being different, about standing out, and it works really well in the classroom for that reason. I love teaching this film. I've used it for teaching ASN learners in particular, who I think identify really well with the little boy in the film. And really get it. They get the idea at the end when you discuss it with them. What is this teaching us? What's this actually telling us? It's not about kids that can really fly. It's about children who are different and about acceptance. And it's quite beautiful. It always makes me choked up when I put it on in the classroom, at the reaction of the father in the film. The Sandman by Paul Berry is a version of the Sandman story that everyone knows. It's an animation. It's quite a creepy, dark, scary animation, but it works really well, again, for teaching horror film genre conventions, and it never fails to get children covering their eyes or going, and some of them have even said, why did you show us that? But it's an excellent short film, so I'll continue to use it. And then finally, one that I've been using a lot recently is Kayak by Antoine Rossi and various other, there's a big long list of French animators. It's a beautiful story of a dad and a baby, and they're sailing down what looks like the Dordogne in France, something like that, in a kayak, but it doesn't go very smoothly. It's a really beautiful wee film. I could go on, there are so many short films I use in the classroom, but these are ones that I use all the time, repeatedly, and I have encouraged my colleagues to use as well, and they do, they're excellent examples. I think I need to stop now, but thank you very much, thanks for listening, and if anyone would like to get in touch, then that's my email address and my Twitter. Thank you.
Thank you. you very much, Louise. Again, lots of interesting stuff there we can pick up on in the discussion later on, and also in the ASN discussion this afternoon, which also this one might tie into too. Here we go. So our next speaker is Isabel Sarran from Inverurie Academy, who is also part of AIMS, the Association of Media Educators Scotland. After Isabel has spoken, we'll get our three panellists up here to have a discussion about the presentation. So if you do have any questions, get them ready, whether you're on Zoom or in the room. Take it away, Isabel.
Thank you. I'll just share the screen for you.
Hello everyone, I'm Isabel. I'm really pleased to be here, thank you for inviting me. I've been asked to talk about short film, obviously, and I have been thinking of what might be the best, the most helpful way of speaking about short films. And I am very much in love with this film, The Silent Child, and I thought it might be helpful to bring this film as an example and look at how versatile short films really can be in the classroom. This film, The Silent Child, is, or might have talked about this first. So I thought I'd talk a bit about the film, and I have broken this down in a very teachery way, if you want, looking at, because obviously we're always having an eye on the aims and what we want to get out for our pupils, and then I have collected some teaching ideas as well for everyone. So this film, The Silent Child, is about 20 minutes long. The director is Chris Overton, and it's conceived by Rachel Shenton, who is a British actress. And the backstory is that her father lost his hearing when, I think, Rachel was about 12, and so they had to start using British Sign Language, and they kind of, it opened her eyes to this kind of deaf culture, and she fell in love. And the film is really, the purpose is to raise awareness, but it's so beautiful. It's very interesting because obviously it won an Oscar, but also they had to do lots of crowdfunding to get finances together for this. The plot is very simple. There's this little girl, Libby. She's about 4 years old, very busy family. She is profoundly deaf, but the family doesn't really understand her needs, and a social worker comes to Anne, and she teaches her sign language, and this child blossoms, but it causes problems in the family. It's very powerful. The film looks at a couple of themes, which I think is part of how we might teach this film. So it looks a lot at isolation, at loneliness, prejudice, disability, and also family relationships. So I think even though deaf culture might be harder to access for the children, a lot of the themes are things they can relate to really well. So when I start planning my teaching, I would always look at what do I want to get out of this, especially for this particular group of learners. Now, this film I have used in many, many different ways. I have used this for S3, especially in the sense of looking maybe at the themes or teaching empathy. I have looked at, I used this film for a NAT5 critical essay, especially during the lockdown where we had kind of this hybrid learning, because that was something nice and compact, yet powerful. I also used it for this for our Scottish qualification, the MPA in Film and Media, as an unseen. This film is really nice for this type of task because obviously it's a short film. A lot of the extra is stripped away. So I find that it really helps children access texts or film texts and short films. So there are a couple of things you can do. You can use this as an introduction for a discussion. For example, we're kind of looking at empathy quite a bit, especially maybe in this kind of S3 area where the children are very opinionated, and that's really something that speaks to them. Your understanding of themes, message, topic might be a nice thing if that's something you want to get out of that. It would work well as a writing prompt for for example, maybe for discursive or persuasive, as well as an open for research. I have used it to teach specific analysis skills, color maybe on mise-en-scène, as I mentioned, the critical essay and the unseen. So once you know what you want to do with it, I think you can pitch it a certain way. So I always think about how I can hook children into a film, how I can sell it to them if you want. I depend a bit on the age of the children. So for BTE, I might use this analysis grid, which I have been taught many years ago by Interfilm as well. So thank you for that, which is a very simple way of looking at an initial analysis of film that looks at similarities. What other text does this film remind you of? It looks at surprises, anything that was unexpected. It looks at puzzles. Do you have still questions? Is anything not very clear? And also patterns. Is anything repeated? So you have this balance of the film relates somehow to the pupil's life, and they can access this way, but also they already start thinking about analysis. This year I have been using some basic BSL. I taught the children thank you and different colors, orange, because I knew they would be used in the film, and then I made them look out for it. So they had this kind of little task, see if you recognize any of the sign language that we have been studying, if you want. It might be nice for the older ones to think about the constraints of a short film and what this means, because that's not just for filmmaking quite important, and thinking about how the director might have made certain decisions and how they film. It also relates later on for the short story writing, as Louise mentioned, because that's quite difficult for pupils to lose all the ballast, if you want. We have been talking with one class about the idea of communication and how we communicate, and started it this way and made this our focus. It was more a theme-based starter. But you can also think about a certain technique that you teach in, and then you let them look out for that. So for example, color is used in this film, or the lack of color. There's also this idea of sound, or the filming of point of view from Libby, the little girl's point of view, where sound is removed and you experience what she experiences. So that's quite powerful. So I thought I'd show you the trailer just in case someone hadn't seen the film yet, and then we can talk a little bit more about what else this is you can do with this film.
I want her to speak.
And I said
you have
to you,
not remembered
she's not
properly.
Hearing anything we're saying.
Susie, I backed you up.
We only found out she was deaf when she was 3 and a half, which probably makes me a bloody awful mother, but Libby follows what we're saying really well.
Right, well, I'm sure she'll be fine then.
We have quite low expectations. We just want her to be a little bit more confident in time for school.
I'm just wondering if we should be focusing more on the lip reading rather than the sign language.
She is normal. She's just deaf.
Do you think she'll be able to get a job one day?
Yeah, I think she'll be able to have a career in whatever she likes.
Oh, God bless her.
Really highlighting this idea of isolation and how isolated really Libby is from everything that's going on. I quite like looking at colors with pupils because, especially with kind of the bare setting, but also the costume. This is quite powerful. For example, Libby has, she gets gets a red coat and Joanne wears this red coat and kind of represents how close they are and how they understand each other and so far away from everyone else. The characterization is quite nice. There's some dialogue in there, but because obviously it's a short film, it's a lot of snippets. And there are scenes, they're very busy, where everyone is talking and everyone's running around, typical family morning, getting ready scene. And the children pick up on that really well, that, and they can relate to this. And they also have very strong feelings about the character, which is nice. So they really don't like the mother, who is presented just not very understanding, like quite selfish. Soundtrack is really nice. So this busyness of the family and all these things that happening, you know, the dishes and the talks in the morning and the car and everything and the honking of the car versus Libby's experience, which is just quiet. And slow motion is used in that sometimes as well. It's really powerful. So everything is, it's quite simple, but it's really profound the way it's done in the film. Now, I use some main focal points for pupils. So I'm looking at the representation of the family quite a bit. So there is a busy table scene that I just mentioned, also the dialogue, the way they speak about her. You saw that from the families, that the family, the grandma and the father, no one really expects much because they see this, like kind of equal the deafness, but being stupid. The mise en scène, especially the final scene, this is not in the trailer, but it's very powerful. So at some point the mother decides she's jealous because no one can communicate with Libby beside Joanne. And then they send Joanne away and they just put Libby in this mainstream school without any support. And it starts really abrupt with the spelling test. And ironically, the first word they have to write down is here. And obviously Libby can't, because she can't hear the word that the teacher is saying. And then you have this last scene, this is where the picture is taken from, where she stands in this playground all by herself, no one plays with her because she can't speak. And it's not a happy ending because she's just left, but that makes it very powerful. And you have the red coats again, and also the blocking of the characters and the colors that work really well. Setting that I mentioned already, again, slow motion and the lack of sound. This is something that if you want to teach techniques and the pupils will make some filmmaking, they can think about to incorporate. And then also this, the kind of key message that, you know, this acceptance of diversity and that disability is not a flaw. Now, I've been thinking how different ways we can tackle this. So I have come up with some discussion questions because I think for pupils that's quite important, maybe especially the older ones. So there are, I just have collected lots of teaching ideas really. The idea that we can look at how can a family adapt to a family member with a disability, because I think for a lot of children this is probably reality, even if it might be just an elderly relative. We've been looking at this idea of how schools respond to the needs. We have been chatting a bit earlier and we all have been talking a little bit about how the additional support needs are rising and how we can meet those. So this is something the children are very aware of as well. This idea of how sign language and giving person a means to communicate can empower them, because in the film, this girl goes from very withdrawn to blossoming and outgoing, and then back to really withdrawn, is a good thing for pupils to look at. And then also the idea of a journey of a character. So that has been one of the things that has been powerful in teaching. Now, I'm a huge fan of task mats. It's just my thing recently. I have this for almost everything. So this is my film discussion place, task mat. This is very open and vague, so it can be used for anything, but I like using short films because I think you might have time to teach one big film and then you have one big outcome, but short films you can repeat and that gives pupils practice, so it's much more powerful. So this is for a group discussion, just giving this to pupils and then let them have a go at a film, and it really goes at give them independence, really, a little bit in that discussion. So we're looking at purpose, we're looking at the message of the film, being able to back this up with examples. We're looking at characters, techniques, and then very important, evaluation. Because I think pupils find this sometimes quite difficult. Again, I'm quite keen, and you will notice this in this placement, that backing it up with examples is something that I kind of insist on. And then you could also go along the way of giving them engaging tasks. Really, this film is quite open for lots of things. So we have been looking at giving them more creative tasks. Imagine you are Libby, think about what you would feel. You're kind of putting yourself in the position of this poor child. Looking at sign language, because obviously sign language is quite different. For example, Scottish sign language is quite different to British sign language. Not completely, but certain signs. Children find this really interesting. I also think they might be looking for swear words first. this idea of writing a persuasive letter, so it doesn't need to always be an essay. I noticed the children are very, very keen on this. A lot of children talk about how they would really like to learn BSL, maybe rather than, I don't know, French or German. This idea of role play, maybe, where they have to communicate without words, they have to find other way of communicating. So these are just some tasks you can do. Now, this is but yet another plasma. I think we skipped that for today. One of the things I'm quite keen is how you can take this further. So I quite like research projects where they can look maybe at disabilities or legislation, designing campaigns for awareness. This can be filming. This can also be written or poster tasks, depending on the resources, because resources is a big issue we're having in schools. Infographics, which is nice for media teaching as well. They can make informal informational clips if they wanted to do that, depending on what your class is like. Some classes tend to work better together than others. One of the things that's really successful when I tried it is giving them a task to have a point of view filming, so film a perspective, basically make the camera the eyes of the character. So for example, they might film, one of them filmed, oh, I'm the new child, and this is my first day, and they filmed how you would walk in and you would have the floor and you have all the noise around, and then you might look up a little bit, this kind of this shyness and this kind of sense of not belonging. I had pupils film the school from a perspective of a very short person or a very young person. They have a lot of fun with that, but it makes them think a little bit of how they can get this across, so this is quite successful. And then, where would you take it? Now, because I've been looking at diversity quite a bit, I have collected quite a few films, short films, that are also looking at this, but would be very engaging for teens. So there is a film, most of them are on YouTube actually, but there's some others as well. There's a film about teenage romance. Again, it's a deaf boy and a hearing girl, and they also have very, very little soundtrack on it, which is quite powerful. So this is a route you can take when you teach film and you're looking at film language and the different techniques. The second one is a short film that looks at disabled parents, which you might know that we have a lot of young carers in our schools. And this is amazing. This little boy is going to the museum with his mom, and he doesn't really want to be there, and the mom is blind. And she says, oh, you pick your favorite artwork, and then you describe it to me. And the boys, they cute, and you know, kind of missing teeth and big glasses. And then he sees this picture, massive painting of a kind of a battle scene, and he breaks out in the most descriptive bit of a speech I have ever heard in my life. And everyone starts clapping afterwards. It's really, really descriptive. It's beautiful. I thought that might be even helpful for English if you want to kind of use this for that. I have included this very simple Indian short film on this list, which is about blindness. It's not great quality. It's not amazing, plot twist and the idea behind it is absolutely amazing, which is there is a blind girl and a boy going on stage. It's like a bit of like Voice UK or something type of things. And he's like, oh, we don't have blind people auditioning. And he says, oh, don't worry, it's actually my sister who's blind, so she goes in the audience. And then he does the amazing dance. And then it turns out it's actually him, and they have this epiphany that obviously they were wrong. But because it's done so simply, I think for pupils this can be quite powerful, because this shows them, a bit like Louise said, that if this can be done, I can do it. The BBC has recently published a documentary, Blood, Sweat and Cheer, which is about a cheerleading team, which is inclusive. So there are wheelchair users in there, amputees, and they follow them around practicing for this cheerleading world championship in America. And at the end they win, which is amazing. We use this, we teach this to our third years. That's very powerful, because what they don't tell you is that they are actually really good, and the editing makes it look like they have absolutely no chance, they are the underdog. Very powerful. So there are a couple more films on here. There is a wheelchair user who's falling in love, and then the plot twist is that the girl he falls in love is deaf. So that's really, really powerful. That's very, very nice for teens, I think. I also have included an awareness clip, mainly because the people speak, there are people with disabilities themselves, but before they talk about their disability, they play out scenes that happen to them regularly, and I think that really pictures what it would be like. It's a little bit triggering because there's talk about mental health, so I would not show that younger children, only seniors. And then on Screening Shorts, which is, you have access via Clo, is a film Coda, which is about a child where of deaf parents, which is quite nice to use as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, all three of our panelists, for three really interesting papers. We've still got a decent amount of time. I think we scheduled 90 minutes and we're just over the hour, so 25-30 minutes for a bit of a discussion with our panelists. So I'd like you to all join me again back up here. We've got three chairs for you. And if you have any questions in the audience, it'd be great to hear from you as well. And if there's any via Zoom, Pascal, just give me a shout. Just take a seat. I'll start us off with some questions. And a really nice link, Isabel, to our second panel as well, and the kind of issues that you were discussing there, some of which came up in Louise's talk as well. I thought what I found really interesting about all three of your presentations, and again, it'd be interesting to hear from the audience, is you all spoke about the difference of short films to feature films, or I think both of Anthony and Louise said short films are more difficult. And Isabel, you talked about the constraints of short filmmaking. Anthony, you kind of mentioned the fact that young people don't tend to watch short films, or maybe nobody watches short films, which is kind of depressing. But I suppose young people, they are familiar with short bits of moving image content, like TikTok or Snapchat or YouTube. So is there a challenge there to kind of bring them on side with how short films work and how they might be different from what they're used to in terms of features, and also like the world of TikTok and YouTube? And how do you kind of overcome those challenges?
I think a lot of the time they are surprised at that. They'll say, is that it? Is that the end of the film? What happened? You know, they do expect there's going to be more, because as you said, they don't realise that short film is an art form in itself. But what's great about that is you can say, well, that's only a few minutes long, you can do that. And that's why I think it works so well. But because so many of them are now making those, they're doing a lot of editing, you know, they're doing a lot of those techniques themselves on their phones, they're doing it for fun in their leisure time, I found that more of them are aware of perhaps that it's something you could do.
Yeah, I was in a school the other day, talking about making films or whatever, and somebody was like, films you make, and I said, oh, just show short films, just try to make stuff. What real films have you made?
What real films?
And I was like, oh, damn. So yeah, it's definitely just, yeah, And they don't necessarily equate like TikTok and stuff to film content, as you know. Like I'll ask them if you watch any films and they'll say no. And I'm like, well, what do you watch then? Netflix? Like it's as if it's this whole thing. Like and obviously YouTube and TikTok as well. So so there's definitely that kind of element, but it's good to sort of, even if you're showing short films that are professionally made, like it kind of manages expectations and, mm-hmm. and you can and given little prompts and things like that can be useful because yeah, I've worked with loads of groups that are basically trying to do Avengers or whatever in the class and you kind of go, oh, okay, so we've got 3 minutes and one day no green screen, so yes. But they just don't connect those dots, I don't think. They don't necessarily say, you know, make a TikTok as the same as making a film where it kind of is.
I think the thing that combines it all is the storytelling, isn't it? So once the children understand that it doesn't matter how long it is, it tells a story, then it clicks for them. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that should be interesting in terms of like the different ways of expressing the story in the short film. You kind of mentioned this about Anthony, like the three act structure is mm-hmm. doesn't quite work in the same way in short films, and they might be more ambiguous or leave things a little bit more open. Is that something that you think young learners might sometimes struggle with as well? Do they want a nice close to meet start, middle and end? Is that something you have to kind of chip away at?
An end probably.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think they would like to have an ending that is satisfying.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't think they don't like the idea of not having a big, you know, explosive sort of climax to things, because that's what they're used to, that's what they expect.
Yeah, it's definitely just about how they understand stories. I think it's either kind of Inception-esque, spinning top, you know, they like that kind of stuff, you know, so if they've made something a bit interesting, it's like, oh, but I was, and another McKendrick quote is, ambiguity does not mean lack of clarity. So I always talk to them about that in terms of like, okay, you can leave it open to options, but we need to know what the options are, which we would understand what we could go. But yeah, I feel like most of the time, especially younger kids or school kids, it's like, usually, like I was sort of saying about, you know, the ending maybe being too big, like if we were trying to teach them storytelling for the short format, most of the time they're like, and then they're solved. That person is complete and they go off in life happy. And I'm like, 3 minutes. Mm-hmm. So it's trying to sort of do that, but I definitely agree that finding an ending for that character or for that situation is definitely useful to them. Mm.
I tend to explain to the pupils, I kind of give them this example of when they go to a party, and their friends are taking a picture. That picture does not tell the whole party, it just tells a snapshot. And a short story and a short film is basically that. It just gives us a tiny little a snap of something. And the rest might not be important because that bit is the story. Hmm. Yeah.
But I think that is really difficult. And I think in terms of, I remember one of my lecturers, I don't think it was you, Graham, one of my lecturers is in the audience. You mentioned this, Louise, I don't know, was like the comparisons between film and literary, but he kind of said like a short film is more like a poem. Like it's really got to distill some big mm-hmm. ideas and themes into a very short kind of space that is much more kind of open than a novel would be, with more clear character development and all that kind of thing. So yeah, I think it's interesting, especially if we don't have young people watching too many short films. It's that relationship between, as you've all spoken about, watching and then using that as a jumping off point to make films. You mentioned this, Louise, what was it you said, if you see it, you can make it. And I wondered across all three of you whether that's something we do enough of or we should do more of, is kind of showing youth-made short films as well, youth-made work, because as you said, it's about managing expectations when they're probably more familiar with Avengers and Marvel and Disney and the massive budgets those films have. So is that something that you tend to do quite a lot?
That's what I start with. I start with showing them things that other young people have made. Because it's a much better entry point, I feel, for their expectations of what they're going to be able to manage themselves. So I do a task at this time of year called Scene Stealers, and it works for lots of different reasons, but they have to recreate a scene from a film that they like, and they just have to go away and make it. I don't teach them anything beforehand. I mean, it's out of lots of necessity, really, time, etc., but it works really well. They love, they think it's great fun. But I'll show them examples that people have done before. And there's a really good one from The Shining where he's breaking down the door and they've made this cardboard door and they've got a cardboard axe with tin foil And you can see light bulbs, you know, going off, clicking, because they can see it's in a school, it looks a little amateur, but they can also see that these kids have done a great job of it. And they go, oh, right, I'm going to go and do this. Some of the kids last year were in my car and they made themselves a makeshift green screen. They got a roll of green paper for the art department, put it up in the window, and they did this, chose a scene out of Ali G. yeah, high art. And we made the scene with them sitting in the front of my car, you know, like they were driving his car. And believe it or not, it actually did a really good job of it. So I show that and I say to the class, you know, look at what they managed to do in the space of a few weeks, you know, with not very much equipment, etc. And it really, you can, yeah, as I said, light bulbs, they're thinking, I can do that. Mm-hmm. That's something I can manage. And then you show them the more professionally made content, you know, that you'd like them to learn from.
Yeah. I think I need to, something to do more of that, but I similarly do that kind of exercise. We also do recreate a film still, so they just take a still photograph and they're using kind of whatever they can find lying about as crowns, or we had like recycling bins that were blue and red, so that was a police car, like good for the science and thing. But so I don't necessarily do a lot of like, here's a film that we've made before, student wise, and then go into the clips, don't necessarily put an album. But the first thing that I always do pretty much in any programme is they just make something like with an icebreaker, I don't do those, I go, right, we're gonna make a fight scene, and I give them foam swords and they have to make a fight scene, and I give them really bad storyboards that I've drawn, and it's just like, I'm gonna get you, not if I get you first type thing. But they just go make that, and then we screen them straight away. So they're just immediately in their own space. This is what we're making, this is what we've done and we've completed and achieved. So then when you go off and you show stills from big films, or you watch short films that are a bit more professionally made, they've still seen what they're going to make because they've just done it like in 2 minutes. So I hope that that helps for them. I used to, early on, but I don't necessarily get a lot of people watching the films being disappointed that it doesn't compare. You know, most of them are just so chuffed to see themselves up there.
Kids are also really good at making spoofs of things, so that's something they quite enjoy. They like this kind of exaggerating everything, kind of, I don't know, agents or kidnapping or something. It's just a lot of fun, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned them being disappointed or not being disappointed anymore. And I think it's a good dynamic between them kind of learning by doing, which you kind of spoke about there, by just jumping in and doing it and learning some of the things that you can then go back and like break it down. And I wondered, yeah, what that relationship is, because you spoke about, you had a really nice analysis of the silent child, like the use of colour and setting. How do you kind of then encourage the young people to get that into their short films? It kind of comes to what you said about the one visual idea and that visual storytelling, which is kind of the cliche, but often when you make films with young people, or certainly when I've tried to, they get very fixated on dialogue and story and plot, and you try and strip that back. What are the kind of challenges?
Somebody said this earlier, but making silent films is good, mm-hmm. you know, making the focus on the visuals and no dialogue. And it depends on the young person. If it's used as a, you know, in a classroom or whatever, they're not necessarily film and interested in film fully, then they more focus on that kind of stuff. Whereas if you've got filmmakers, they are people interested in film, they focus on shots and stuff, and they don't care about story. They're just like, ooh, what if we move through here and things? So it can be challenging, but you know, obviously we all have to teach analysis stuff, or especially in the teaching settings that you guys are used to. But you know, we're all just trying to sort of connect the dots between that, the kind of critics tool, the analysis tool, but also the filmmakers' creative decisions. And I'm always just trying to hammer home that filmmakers make creative decisions for a reason, for a purpose. You know, that's why we can analyse it, because the director's controlling every aspect of the frame, and hopefully that they go away from that, at least trying to think of elements and focus. And usually it is shots that you focus on, because if you're in a classroom with a bunch of kids in a uniform, we don't have a lot of resources necessarily to get, here's a whatever, here's a cape, here's a hat. You know, it's mostly just them. Mm-hmm. So they focus on shot, they focus on angle, they focus on the performance, and using what you have, basically, that's a key thing to put from the people you have. So.
Yeah, it depends a lot on what's who your learners are and what their interests are, I think. So I had once a group of pupils who went they were on to mountain biking, and they would over weeks take shots mountain biking, and they became better and better at it because they had this practice. So they would have, I mean, my favorite bit was the camera just below a little puddle, and then they drove through the puddle and it splashed, amazing. But they got so into it, they even wrote their own song. But when I remember when we, yeah, they had a band, they had their own song, amazing. Yeah, sometimes pupils have a plan and it doesn't work out, and something totally new is born, and that's also really good. That's because then they realize, okay, my idea was maybe too big, I wanted too many things, or I often they underestimate how long it takes as well. But actually, I have to be honest, I often, when we film, we tell them maybe not focus on dialogue too much because the recording equipment isn't very good. So they can focus more on the visual, and then gives them constraints that actually kind of release more creativity in some ways. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, you have to think about your brief really carefully.
Yeah.
What I tend to do is start with teaching montage, so that it gives like lots of different elements of narrative and mise-en-scene in quite a short space of time. So for example, higher media, I start with the Godfather, the scene at the end of the baptism, and how, you know, it's got everything in it. It does a lot of stuff really kind of shorthand, quick way of teaching them, and then I get them to focus on mise-en-scene and not just think about, you know, I want people playing football. Yeah. What do you want the background to look like? What sort of costume? You know, is there anything you can do to make it not be school uniform? Take off your, put on a hoodie, or, you know, like thinking about that sort of thing, the costumes that they're going to wear. I mean, you can make quite an effective film using just what you've got. And mm-hmm. some of the best films that I've had were filmed on our school grounds. A really good horror movie was filmed in the trees. We've got a lot of trees around our school, which was, it was pretty creepy. And did a good job of it. So yeah, just trying to get them to focus on not just, you know, I want to scare people, or I want to tell a story about footballers because that's so popular. It's always a common theme. Try to get them to focus on what you want it to look like. Yeah, sound is always an issue. Sound is challenging.
So with the microphones on the iPad. Mm-hmm. Do I have any questions from the audience? Where to use it, the films that I, yeah, make sure you watch them first before you show them the premier settings or whatever, because I don't know, some of them are different or that. But yeah, short films don't necessarily have a kind of classification like the BBFC, so, you know, it is about watching them, and it's my experience about watching them and trying to, you know, understand who it's best for. I'm sure that some places like Screaming Shorts and stuff will have little guidelines, and Vimeo has like Mature and things, so you do get a little idea maybe, but it is mostly about sort of understanding. But I'm interested by the kind of, yeah, of young people. Quite often young people want to make films about mature topics because they just kind of, you know, something that's either really silly and ludicrous, or most of the time it's about something so mature. But ultimately I try and just let them lean into it because it should be about them expressing themselves, and it can be a little bit awkward when the kids are coming up with really heavy stuff and you worry about showing it to other kids or things like that. But ultimately, if they're landing on these mature topics, they're landing on them for a reason, you know, whether it's about home life or whether it's about things that they've heard or read, and
mean, I get them making a fight scene, you know what I mean? So it always descends into violence and things. But hopefully it's quite flipping and they kind of enjoy that. But yeah, I do kind of lean on the side of doing that, so I'm interested in what you guys say in terms of like school environment and having to sort of quench that a little bit more, maybe.
Well, that's a good question. The biggest piece of advice is just watch whatever you're going to show first.
Yeah.
Short film wise. The Sandman that I mentioned is actually genuinely quite scary. So even though it's an animation and it doesn't say it's unsuitable for primary school children, some kids would be really freaked out by it. So it's a bit like when you're a parent, parental guidance, watch it and see if it's suitable for the people in front of you, because every class is different. And some people will be very scared by that and other people will be absolutely fine with it. Virus, the one I mentioned as well, always makes people jump. But it's not, there's nothing in it that's gory or anything like that. So yeah, just, and there's, as you said, there's also warnings, and screening shorts does have really quite specific information about who the audience really would be best for. In terms of filmmaking, I just basically let them at it. I don't really say no very often. And we'll have conversations about things like, well, I give them a brief and it's a teenage audience, which is quite wide, so that does allow them for, you know, making a film that might be considered a 15 certificate, for example, because they're all of that age at higher media level, for example. With the younger pupils, they don't tend to want to broach into anything too massively inappropriate. Not that I've come across. Maybe it's just because they're like, oh, we're in school, you know, the teacher's going to watch this. I don't know if it's self-censorship, but yeah, try not to say no, because I don't want to curtail their creativity, because that's the whole point of it. The whole point is that they get to do this. It's not about me at all, and it's not about what I would like to watch. And yeah, filmmaking, the mantle of the expert, getting right into that world and, you know, getting them to do it for themselves is really important, so don't try not to do too much of that.
I can also say this has never happened. I have never come across where I have to say no. There might be topics where heavier topics where you might have to have an eye on child protection, a bit like with writing pieces, because you will have to think, well, where's this coming from? Is this a personal experience? And so it's more child welfare issue, but yeah, I've never had to censor like this before, yeah.
They mostly want to make horror movies, in my experience.
I was going to ask about it. Why horror movies are so popular with?
I don't know. I think it's a teenage target audience,
yeah,
for the majority of horror movies anyway, and it's quite often teenage protagonists,
yes,
that are in that genre. But it's also got the most obvious genre markers,
yes,
that are things that they can try to do for themselves,
yeah,
and they love that challenge of trying to, you know, use
them.
So
scared.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah,
and they like being scared. And
I guess it's the easier. It's an easier genre. Aspects to do is for more money as well, isn't it? Yes, let's do sci-fi. No. How do we do that? Although we did paint, once when I was in a private school, one of the students was an alien and she got painted green, and nobody checked how easy the green was to come off. So she was green for a couple of weeks, and I was like,
talking about a different landscape in Scotland in terms of film and media education, and maybe our curriculum is a bit more open and welcoming of film and media than down south. And how does those kind of media literacy skills about being critical about the media we consume relate to the filmmaking projects that you guys involve with? Thanks, Graham. Especially given, you know, the ubiquity of social media for young people. Is that part of, we kind of touched on this a little bit in the previous question, sensitive topics, is it part of your thinking in teaching film and media, like enabling young people to be critical of media?
Yeah, do you know, I'm glad you brought that up, because I don't know if I necessarily do that enough in terms of saying black people being aware of what they're watching, whatever, but in terms of getting them making stuff and teaching, like, I always focus on story, and that's the idea of having a purpose, you know, that's something that a film should have a purpose, it exists for a reason. Mm-hmm. So we talk a lot about the central dramatic argument and what a film is trying to say, and it's useful because young people aren't necessarily thinking about that, so it makes them aware of what their film is saying. So if they were handling a sort of really tricky topic, and it was all okay in the end, or it was all quite terrible in the end, or whatever it may be, you kind of say, well, what is your film actually saying? And it's actually saying something quite, you know, devastating or quite whatever. So getting them, you know, even, you know, obviously that's hard at a younger age, I'm aware of that, but getting them talking about that does help them sort of understand what a piece of media is trying to say, what a filmmaker is saying, what an author is saying. But we're always focused on the fact of, like, this is what that person is saying, you know, not a collective, it's not fact, it's not certain, it's about a sort of opinion. And I usually introduce this idea of playing that game of, like, you know, go to the corner, whether you strongly agree, disagree, strongly disagree, and they'll, you know, McDonald's or KFC or whatever, and then, like, kind of getting more serious from that. So, yeah, trying to make sure that they have an opinion when they're doing their work is kind of speaking to that a little bit, but I think what you bring up is really interesting because, yeah, I don't necessarily do enough of that. But then I've not necessarily felt the need to, because most people that I've dealt with doesn't feel like they're necessarily dealing with that, I guess, but maybe I'm just not feeling that enough, maybe because of the limited time I have. It's definitely giving me food for
thought. I think in Scotland we're really well placed in terms of the fact that film and movie and image is considered part of the English curriculum, literacy curriculum, therefore there's not the same barriers to including it, and also because of that I think people teach media in English quite a lot across the nation, and media literacy has become increasingly important, and the role of teaching media literacy is, I feel, a huge burden on me, like a really important thing for me to do. So I get my department teaching about, you know, news media and the messaging and where it's coming from. Who is saying this? Why are they saying it? What's the difference between fact and opinion? The BBC journal, what's it called? Young Reporter, BBC Young Reporter award or scheme. Sorry, they've got some really good resources on their website that young people can access, that teachers can use in the classroom, which is about differentiating between, you know, fake news and real news, and how do you know that a source is reliable? So that's something that we do in the classroom. I'm sure I'm not alone in that up and down Scotland, that people are interrogating that and teaching the young people that. And I think it's important, it's on everyone's curriculum. English teachers are, and media teachers are quite well placed to teach that. It's not only our job, but I think that's something that we often take on. In terms of media as a subject, because it's not just film in Scotland, those two things are combined. We have the role of the media that has to be covered, and in terms of awards and grades and everything, that's worth 20% of their final award if they get a national 5 or a higher media qualification. And we cover a wide range of media for that. A lot of people teach advertising, but it's got issues there in terms of how the media functions in our society, who's selling us these ideas. Interrogating that, having opinions, having responses to it. News media is also something that people teach for that, and things like headlines and different publications, and, you know, who's behind it, who's funding it, and that's certainly part of the media qualification that we have in Scotland, that teachers have to deliver. So I think we're fairly well placed for it in terms of its place in the curriculum, but there's not enough of it, so.
Mm-hmm.
also let's not forget that part of analysis is to understand how these techniques and films are used to influence you and to impact you and to create certain feelings, mm-hmm. maybe. So the more pupils understand that, or children understand that, the more they become immune because they understand how this kind of manipulation works. Yeah.
That's great, thank you. And the second part was about intellectual property or copyright, which I assume comes into the higher media somewhere, does it? Maybe not?
Not in and of itself.
Okay.
But you do come across issues of intellectual property when making media content.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, that they haven't considered that things like copyright, but you can use things for educational purposes without,
yes.
If you're not going to have it on YouTube and you're not going to make profit from it, then, because otherwise it would be quite difficult for some, in a lot of circumstances, to access, you know, images or, you know, music that you might want to use, for example, but that's just for like an assignment.
In the NPA courses, copyright is covered.
Yeah.
And this is something that is looked at, again, especially in connection with the films they make themselves or the output they make themselves.
Yeah, I think that's what, I mean, in terms of like demoing, I guess, the, you know, their work, it can be challenging with part of the program, a lot of people involved, but we all at GMAC, we're always trying to do industry like standards, so no matter the program, the writer will sign a release and the director will sign a, you know, let all these things happen, and it's their film and they can do with it as they wish. And, but yeah, that can be complicated when it gets into sort of, you know, the film academy or the programs. And, it's a shame. It depends on the program, it depends on the person, but a lot of them do it and then move on. Do you know what I mean? They're not necessarily that, well, hopefully they've taken the information to go and make something, but they seem to just kind of accept that it kind of existed in its time. And then it will go up on a website or whatever, but then we could have gone and they're ready to do their own
mm-hmm.
stuff. Okay. Well, thanks very much. I'm aware we're encroaching into the lunch break. Do we have any questions from Zoom?
Yes.
We've got one in the room as well.
If you're able to read it.
Yes, please do.
This is from Paula, Paula Murphy. She asks, do any of the panelists use short documentaries for educational short films?
I do teach short documentaries, and now I'm trying to think
mm-hmm.
what they're called. I've taken quite a few media classes to the sadly no longer in existence, the Film and Media Days at the Edinburgh International Film Festival, and one of the great things about that was that the programme included not just feature film and not just fictional films, but also included documentary, and that was both shorts and feature length documentaries. And throughout the year saw a number of really good short documentaries there. And it's an art form that a lot of people don't consider. Most people do tend to teach, you know, fiction, but non-fiction is really valuable and it has exploded in popularity. I taught the series called The Jinx. I don't know if anyone has heard of this, and I suppose it could be considered to be short documentary because it's six episodes of 50 minutes. It's about Robert Durst. I don't know if anyone has heard of this man, but it came before Making a Murderer, and when I showed it to my class, we got to the final episode, you could hear the pin drop in the room. They were absolutely astounded, like just blown away by it. And I don't know why I didn't do it again. It was maybe to do with the time, because it was six full episodes, plus I was teaching a feature film, but got a lot out of that that we wouldn't have got out of fiction, I suppose. So yeah, do use short documentary. We'll maybe pass on to you if I can remember the examples that I've used.
I have used true crime, because true crime has been kind of a trend, and the pupils are quite interested in that. There are a couple of different things you can do. There are documentaries online. There's quite a lot on YouTube as well, YouTubers that look into that, and that you have this kind of storytelling in there. They really like that. The BBC Blood, Sweat, Tears is a documentary, even though it's a documentary, but obviously it kind of really kind of leads you around. But this can be quite an aha moment if you wanted that. I think that could be working quite well.
What about GMAC?
Yeah.
Is that something?
Yeah, we in terms of me and my side of stuff at GMAC, we do tend to focus on fiction, you know, and teaching or the programs that I'm on. But sometimes your documentary will come up because they're thinking of something or because it came from them, and then we'll maybe cover some aspects, but do tend to focus on similar things in terms of an argument, in terms of, you know, three acts, I guess, basically. And I'm not a boring three act guy, by the way, but I'm just, I just love it as a sort of useful tool. But so yeah, so sometimes, you know, mockumentaries come up a lot with young people, so they always want to do kind of office style things, so we tend to talk about that. And then we also do behind the scenes films in some of our projects, so we like kind of exploring that and you know, maybe showing clips from like Lost in La Mancha or, you know, these big filmmaking documentaries that are all about the Midland, basically. but not enough to sort of.
Super Says Me.
Oh, yeah.
I know this is quite old, but the children really enjoyed that. And there was recently a film about this free climber. I just can't remember the name. I think his name was Mark something. But that's a feature length. That's a full film. But I think that would be quite successful for pupils.
Yeah, the question did say short docs, and I don't actually have that many examples. But I tend to try and find local ones. The Scottish Documentary Institute.
Yeah.
They've got their website and stuff. They're great people to just get in touch with. So there's sort of scheme bridging the gap for kind of newer filmmakers making docs. There's always some great interesting shots there, so it's just
in terms of educational stuff, I just remembered we do a second year English unit on David Attenborough, and we do an episode of our Blue Planet 2, and then we do another episode from one of his other series to teach various different things. It's really useful teaching tool. We really love the David Attenborough documentaries. It goes down really well in class.
Excellent. Do we have any more online questions?
No, that was it.
Yeah, Lewis, do you want to ask your final question?
Thanks so much for your time. Really interesting. Nice to get some short films for me to watch. Trade journey. I think my question is probably sort of combined with fears, I suppose, about doing teaching kids how to make a bargain, but doing some leading things, it's the same engagement thing, but particularly in front of the camera, and getting kids to sort of perform and act, if you like, particularly at our school, we don't have any fun to teach them. So my question is, have you ever had kind of issues with that, with kids just not wanting to be in front of the phone, and so suggestions?
There's always kids that do not want to be in front of the camera in their own film, but they can usually persuade, you know, either other group members or some of their friends who are not necessarily in that class to, we are quite happy to be in front of the camera. We're lucky enough, we've got a drama department and they're really good, and they can usually find someone that does drama, but they don't need to be in their own film. Certainly not. It's not, you know, the acting is not the thing really.
Yeah, usually find that just kind of hope that somebody in the group will be alright and be in front. But sometimes I'm also, I tend to find the, you know, once that's at least happened once, because somehow trying to make sure that everybody ends up doing it so they feel more comfortable. So people that don't want to do it, like, if it feels like everybody, not everybody else has it, they feel isolated, but just that there's been so many exercises where it's been here, there and everywhere, they might just end up doing it by accident, which I've had a couple of times. And you know, the retreat of film still a thing that sometimes they're in it's a lot extra, but then they start to come out.
Yeah, so that those sort of tasks you talk about.
Yeah, just kind of
thing you talk about and they can do it like
start. Yeah, exactly, because they're straight in it. So most of the people, you know, you get like people don't want to be on camera, but as soon as you say like you're getting someone, you get to think like, and they're like just like straight into it. So I tend to try and encourage it a little bit. But then yeah, if they just don't
could probably also consider using shots where the face, which is normally what they don't want to show, is not shown, like over the shoulder shots, or maybe just kind of close up of hands or something. I'm sure they can work around this, at maybe at the beginning at least, until they feel more comfortable. Yeah.